I'm sure many of you are familiar with a device such as this one. This is an AVR ISP Mark II, a microcontroller programmer. And just as a microcontroller programmer should do, it takes our compiled code that we wrote on our computers and transfers it into our microcontroller. And normally, this whole process works without a hitch. That is until we end up programming one of the fuse bits or lock bits incorrectly. At that point, this becomes basically a glorified paperweight. That is, until we use a parallel programmer to save our microcontrollers. You see, parallel programmers are sort of like the ultimate programming method for microcontrollers, as they can kind of overcome any software issue we may come up with. So join me today in this video as I show you how parallel programmers work and how you can make one of your own. First, let me explain what usually causes these lockouts. Typically, you will program your microcontroller using the ISP protocol, using a programmer much like the one I showed in the intro. That is, until you incorrectly program a fuse bit or a lock bit. For example, you could set the reset disable fuse bit and essentially disable ISP programming. In my case, I have an ATmega AA that I was using for a previous video. I ended up changing the clock fuses and wasn't able to get the device to work afterwards. Either way, parallel programming is able to overcome really any software lockouts because it uses a 12-volt pulse to signify the start of programming. This 12-volt pulse should never be found anywhere in normal, everyday use, so it works perfectly fine for starting the programming process. I'll show you how to do this both by hand and also with your own dedicated circuit, so that you don't have to worry about losing a microcontroller over such an annoying fuse error. The best place to start is with the device datasheet. And since my example involves the ATmega AA, I'll be using that datasheet for now. But if you are using, say, an ATmega 328P, you can still follow along for the most part. The process is nearly identical, except for a few small differences, such as the device signature and the extended fuse. You'll find that most of the 28-pin AVR microcontrollers have a similar process anyways. The first couple of pages of the datasheet show you what each fuse and lock bit represents. And make sure to pay special attention, since in this case, a 0 means that the bit is programmed, not a 1. There are a couple of dangerous fuses that will stop you from using ISP programming as well. Here is a helpful diagram that shows you the pins that we'll need. And, as you can see, there are a lot of pins involved, 18 in total, not including ground, VCC, and AVCC. This is why I will say that, in most cases, parallel programming is not at all practical. You'll usually only want to use this method when you need to reset those fuse and lock bits. Otherwise, you'll normally stick to the ISP protocol, which uses those 6-pin headers instead. Anyways, on the next page, we can see the function of all the pins. And since we are starting out by programming by hand, let's connect all the inputs, the ones that say I, to ground, except for OE and WR, since the line above them means that they're active low. So we will want to connect those to VCC to deactivate them. I'd also recommend setting up a button that can pull the WR pin low to make programming easier later. Set up a pull-down resistor in conjunction with the button connected to the VCC to make our clock pulses on XTEL 1 as well. On the RDY pin, put an LED so that we can see the status of the programming. And finally, put 8 LEDs on each of the data pins, so that we can read the output later. Now we have just one more pin to tackle, which is the 12-volt pulse on the reset pin. Now, we have to be really careful about the 12 volts, since it can only be on the reset pin. The rest of the circuit can only handle 5 volts. For our power supply, we will start out with those 12 volts, and then use an LM317 to regulate down to 5 volts for everything else. This is a good solution, but we still need our 5 volt signals to be able to switch those 12 volt signals when we automate the process with another microcontroller later on. The best component for this job is a transistor. So, I came up with this design, but let's test it in real life before we put it into the working circuit. First, I set up our button so that it connects down to ground. We also need a pull-up resistor to 12 volts so that the output stays at ground when not in use. Otherwise, the circuit is just a simple transistor switch that involves another resistor for the 12-volt pull-up on the output. Now, when I flip the switch, we get 12 volts, and when I flip it again, we get 0 volts. In the actual circuit, I'll be using this switch because we'll need to continually apply the 12 volt signal. And before anyone leaves a comment, yes, if you are doing this entirely by hand, skip this transistor part and just use a button, because this is all set up for when we automate the process later on when using a microcontroller's pins. Next, it's definitely for the best to plan out the steps that we will take to reset and unlock our locked microcontroller. First, I'd say it's best to verify the device signature. This is because we can make sure that everything is plugged in correctly, and we can make sure that we are actually plugging in the correct targeted device. Second, we will run a chip erase. This will reset all the lock bits, flash, and EEPROM, but not the fuses. Next, we will program the high and low fuse bytes, most likely to the factory default, but it really is up to you. And finally, we'll verify the lock and fuse bits. After that, your microcontroller should be good as new, so let's get started with this. First, we need to enter programming mode. Luckily, the datasheet gives us some very explicit instructions for this. There are two algorithms that it gives us. The first is for the majority of circumstances, and the second is for when certain fuses block programming mode. And those fuses are the clock select and reset disable bits, for example. Since my microcontroller did have those problems, I had to use the second method, so I'll show that one first. The algorithm for it goes as follows. Set the prog enable pins to 0. And if you're wondering, the prog enable pins are page L, XA1, XA0, and BS1. And if you followed along so far, they should already be 0. The next step is to simultaneously apply 5V power and 12V to reset. This can be a bit tricky when you're doing it by hand, but the best way to do this I found is to pre-configure your switch to apply 12V automatically, and then apply power to the entire circuit all at once. And congratulations, if your ready light is on, then you're now in programming mode. And for everyone else who's using method 1, here are the steps real quickly. First, power up the device with 5V power. Do not apply 12V yet. Next, toggle your XTAL1 clock 6 times, and make sure that those prog enable pins are 0. And you may now finally apply the 12V and watch your ready LED come on. Now we are officially able to start programming our fuse and lock bits. But before we get into that, let's actually make sure that everything is correctly configured by checking our device signature. We'll check for these 3 bytes, which specify that the microcontroller is an 8KB ATmega AA manufactured by Microchip. The datasheet provides some instructions for this. First, we need to set XA1 to 1 and keep XA0 at 0. This will put us into load command mode. Next, we should set BS1 to 0, but it should already be that way. Next, we need to drive our data pins. It tells us to load command 000100, which represents reading the signature and calibration bytes. Press our XTAL clock button to load our command into the microcontroller. Remember these steps, since they form the basis of all command loading. Now, we need to load the address of the signature bytes. Their addresses are 0, 1, and 2. To do that, we need to follow a similar process to loading a command. The main difference is that we set both the XA1 and XA0 to 0 to get into load address mode. For starters, we will load address 0 into the data bus, and also keep BS1 at 0. Finally, pulse the clock to save your settings. Now we are ready to read our data. Make sure to disconnect any driving pins on the data bus. I don't want you to accidentally short circuit anything. Now drive OE to 0, and that will enable the output. On the output, we can now see the first signature byte. You should be getting 1E, which is 00011110 in binary. Repeat the load address process 2 more times, but this time with address 1 and 2 to get the other 2 bytes. And they should be 93 and 07 in hex, respectively, considering that you got an ATmega AA. Check your datasheet for the other microcontrollers. And if everything checks out, it's time to start programming. Let's start with our lock bits, since they will block programming of our fuses otherwise. And the only way to unprogram a lock bit is with a chip erase. Remember, chip erases erase lock bits, EEPROM, and flash, but not fuses. Again, the datasheet also provides us with a step-by-step guide on how to perform a chip erase. Just like with the signature bytes, set XA1 and XA0 pins into load command mode. Keep BS1 at 0, set your data to the chip erase command, which should be all zeros except for the most significant bit. This represents our chip erase command. Press our clock button to load our command into the microcontroller. All that is left to do now is to give WR a negative pulse to execute our write command. And depending on how quick your eyes are, you might be able to see the ready light flash off for just a tiny bit. It was only off very briefly because the microcontroller processes things very, very quickly. But that LED tells us whether the microcontroller is busy and if it's ready to accept further instructions. Now, let's change the fuse bits. You've probably already caught on to the pattern by now. So first, load the write fuse bits command into your microcontroller. remember to set the XA1, XA0, and BS1 pins correctly. But here's a new step. We now need to load data into a microcontroller. The process is almost identical, except for one thing. Set XA1 to 0 and XA0 to 1. This is the load data mode. At this point, now load your low fuse bits into the device. I'll be loading hex C1. Keep in mind, this is important. We are doing the low fuse first. Now, pulse your clock to load the fuse bits. And finally, pulse the WR pin to save your changes. The high fuse is almost the exact same as the low fuse. The only difference is that right before you pulse the WR pin, change BS1 to a 1. This just selects the high fuse byte instead. For my data in the high bit, I'll be putting hex 99. And after pulsing WR, reset BS1 back to 0. And you should be done. And you could stop programming here, but we should double check the fuses and lock bits to avoid later frustration. To read these bytes, load the read fuse and lock bits command, which is 00000100. From this point on, you will be able to read the data by setting output enabled to 0 and by switching through the combinations of BS1 and BS2. Again, make sure you move any driving wires to avoid short circuits. Set BS2 and BS1 to 0, and you will be able to read the low fuse bytes. Next, set them both to 1, and you will be able to read the high fuse byte. Finally, set BS2 to 0 and BS1 to 1, and you will get the lock bits, which should all be 1. After you verify the status of these bits, you are now done with programming. Reset output enable back to 1, and then turn off the 12-volt signal on the reset pin. You may now power down the device and your changes are now saved. Congrats! We have just recovered this microcontroller, and we can now program it using the traditional ISP method. And this method is surprisingly practical if you have just one bricked microcontroller. But I know that some of you will get annoyed by using this bit-banging method over time, especially if you have hundreds of chips to recover. So, the remainder of this video will be about creating an automated device to do this all for us. Ideally, this automated device should be able to quickly reset several AVR microcontrollers. And that's why I got this handy 28-pin ZIF socket that will allow us to simply drop in a microcontroller and quickly reset it. Quite conveniently, many of these classic AVR microcontrollers have the reset pins on pin 1, at least in the DIP package. So we can simply set up the high voltage to always be at that location. As the brains, I use another ATmega AA. I also added two LEDs that will indicate either a failure or a success in reprogramming. The power to the other microcontroller will be supplied through a PNP transistor, which will be toggled by a signal on the programmer. As for the code, I basically wrote in the microcontroller what we just did by hand, and you'll be able to review the entire code in the description below. But here are a few of the more important functions that I'll show you in the video. The start programming method applies these two methods from earlier, and we're able to see if it was successful based on the RDY output being high. The load command function will take our command and go through the entire process of setting up the microcontroller's pins to get it into the load command mode and then loading the specified command. The same goes with the load address function. There are also multiple helper functions just like these. I then wrote larger functions like chip erase and fuse write that contain those helper functions. Again, it's just the same thing that we did, but the microcontroller is the one doing it now. Anyways, since this all works on the breadboard, I'd say it's about time to solder it all together. And so, after a few hours of soldering, the project is now officially a part of my programming toolkit. So, let me show you it in action. First, I will lock myself out of this ATmega AA for demonstration purposes. I set all the lock bits and set the reset disable fuse. And as you can see, we can no longer access it by using ISP programming anymore. So, to recover the microcontroller, we just place it into the ZIF socket. Then, we press the button and the rest takes care of itself. The LEDs let us know what happened. It will turn green when the process was successful. However, when something goes wrong, it will turn red. For example, it will turn red if there was no microcontroller plugged in. And that just about does it for this device. Well, there you have it. You should now be able to save your microcontrollers from any software lockouts that you may encounter. If this video did help you save your microcontroller, I'd really like to encourage you to check out my Buy Me a Coffee page. You see, these videos take a considerable amount of time, effort, and testing to make, and with your support, I can continue making more of them. Big thanks, by the way, to the people who are already supporting me. Anyways, as always, have a good one!